So, it's after lunch time. So some of you might be in a little bit of a lunch dip. And then it's my challenge actually to wake you up a little bit. And hopefully I'm going to wake you up with a couple of references actually to the past talks that we had before the lunch. With a couple of things that are more or less like intentional. Because first of all, my name is not Jitse. And it's not Jesse or something. It's Jisse. So, goddamn, fucking hell! Why can't you just remember this? Like, it's so fucking simple. Like, so that's the first reference. Like, I'm not from the UK. English is not my native language, so I'm apparently allowed to swear. So, Sonia, where are you? So sorry. So my name is. Jisse. Another thing, kind of like a reference to before lunchtime, is that I'm wearing a cap intentionally, because if I'm removing the cap, suddenly I look a little bit like Douglas. So, Jisse? Douglas. Yes, Douglas. So it's like a lookalike. I'm not sure if you guys are familiar with the German term Doppelgänger. Yeah? So that's actually like I'm Douglas, his doppelganger, or he's mine, or well. So, but I'm Jisse. I'm wearing a cap, what I do is a couple of things. I'm the founder of a small company called Yerio. What I do there is I train developers. What I'm also doing is organize a couple of events. One of which is Mage Test Fest, which is going to take place in March next year in Florence. And one of the cool things about Mage Test Fest is actually we're going to talk about tests and tests and tests and how to prevent fuck-ups of the code. So it's actually one of the rare conferences where swearing suddenly has a real purpose. I'm also part of the organizer of ReactorCon, which took place actually 1 month ago, focusing on PWA, but I'm also discussing PWA in a lot of different ways, user groups, hackathons. I'm part of the XDN network, Magento Master 2017 and 2018, and sometimes I'm actually called Knockout Jisse, which I'm really proud of, but there's two ways actually of interpreting it, and I'm first going to focus a little bit more on the wrong way of interpreting it, because the nickname Knockout Jisse didn't actually start with something else, but actually with this knockout gate. Anybody of you already heard of Knockout Gate?
Me.
Yeah. So somebody invented this Knockout Gate because Anton Krill, I have to say that correctly, director of architecture of Magento, announced 1 week ago in Meet Magento New York that Knockout.js, or actually the whole front end with XML layout and PHTML and block classes and Knockout and require and a shitload of JavaScript, is all going to be deprecated. And that got a lot of people angry because of, well, if you deprecate something that so many shop owners are dependent on, something is going to be wrong. So suddenly, like the term Knockout Gate was also invented by, I think Karen Baker was the first one to come up with it. And I asked her last night, like, well, who came up with it? And then she said, well, you did. Okay, so I wrote a blog post actually on my reaction of why Knockout as a front end is to be deprecated and why it's a good thing. We're going to move forward with another thing, PWA. So PWA is not really my intention of the whole slide set, but it forms like a fundamental basis of my talk. So here's a slide on PWA. To make sure that you get the point, it's a hype. So here's another slide on PWA. However, it's still not the point of why I'm actually being called Knockout Jisse, because Knockout Jisse actually has to do with all of the stuff that I'm actually doing. So I'm overwhelming myself with so many different projects and open source initiatives that I'm just really busy with everything. And if you're busy so much with everything, then you're looking forward to discussions with Rebecca as being part of this, I'm not saying it right, the open source health, mental health, OSM. MH initiative. I'm just being overwhelmed with the stuff that I do, and then sooner or later you start drinking. And I did so last year, and last year I went to an unconference, and actually during this unconference I was so drunk that I actually attended the pre-party, but I didn't attend the unconference itself, so hence I was called Knockout Jisse. Moving on. So the reason also why I'm putting this up on a slide is basically because, if you drink too much, you're starting to see duplicates. And this brings us back actually to this point of a doppelganger, that you're seeing duplicates and then maybe you're seeing twice the same thing, but you know one version is good and then the other one is not. So there's a good version and there's an evil version. Leading up to hopefully somebody knows Twin Peaks, anyone? So the old series had Dale Cooper in it, and then after a while there was the good Dale and the evil Dale. So who's the evil Dale? Well, the guy on the right, the evil one. Another movie reference, Evil Dead, anyone? So then there's Ash, and sooner or later Ash is possessed by his hand, and then suddenly his hand tries to attack himself, and then in the end he chops off his hand and he replaces it with a chainsaw and etc. Then it becomes really horror-like. But who's the evil one? Well, the guy on the right. Another one to get you in the same sphere, who's the evil politician? So actually, now I'm not sure anymore. Somebody warned me, do not bring up Brexit as a topic. So I'm not. Anyway, another one. What is the evil UI component? Well, you can't see the difference. And that's maybe the point that I want to make. What I did was replace actually the React or the normal mini card written in Knockout, require PHTML and the whole thing, that the whole shebang that makes up the current front end, and replace it with the React component, which is the one on the right. But you can't see the difference. And that was basically my point, and that's basically the point that I want to make in this presentation. What if we could replace a certain part of the current front end with another React component and slowly move things forward with PWA? So the rest of my presentation is actually about this, how to move it forward, how to migrate the code from one point to the other, from the current front end to a new front end. So first of all, a little bit of a summary, but I'm assuming that you're more or less aware of it. So as soon as you've started with front-end development in Magento, you know about Knockout. Its initial release in 2010. There are better alternatives, but back then it was a good alternative to Angular, but currently Knockout is actually already deprecated and being replaced with other libraries like React, Vue, Polymer, and so on. So basically it's like a deprecated situation. And then actually the image should show also the summary of what is about, what is there to tell about UI components. Because UI components are then built on top of this Knockout library to create a combination of technologies, XML layout, blocks, PHTML templating, required.js mixins, Knockout, HTML templates, and on top of that, additional Magento logic, which makes it simply overly complex. And that's my main point. As soon as you've dived into the Knockout front end that we use currently, you might be eager to actually hear about another front end coming up. So the big question is, how to replace all of this, which is actually overly complex, with something better. So I picked actually the mini card, because the mini card is actually hanging together also with a lot of functionality, but theoretically this is not the holy grail. If you dive into front-end development, you know that there's a certain part of the Magento front-end that is like the complete nightmare of everything, and that is actually the checkout. So the holy grail would actually be to improve the checkout in such a way that extending it, customizing it, and et cetera, would be more acceptable. But as an experiment, I did this with the mini card itself, just to show what kind of steps could we take. So migrating could mean migrating to React. And this is simply open for debate. So if you're really diving into the whole PWA stuff, it's not about PWA that much. It's much more about a headless situation, disconnecting the front end and the back end so that you are at liberty to choose whatever technology you want to use in the front end while the back end remains Magento. So in other words, React is just a choice. I just followed along with it because it's a JavaScript framework. It's simpler than the Knockout framework as we work with right now. It's combining a lot of technology, but in the end, the major point why I was choosing for React is simply that Magento is going to use it in their PWA Studio solution. However, whatever I come up with in the upcoming slides is a possible solution to migrate, is also possible in Angular, is also possible in Vue. It's just a matter of choice. Well, that's the fun part. Now comes the more complex part, the technical part. Whatever I'm going to show you in the slides is actually online for you guys to see. I've got this Yerio repository. However, this is a Yerio desk training repository to make sure that it's not production code, it's an experiment. It's there to modify, to learn from, etc. But to me, it's more like an experiment. To you guys, it might be something useful for production on the long run. But it's just part of a discussion ongoing. Within this module that I've created, I've done a couple of tricks. First, to get rid of the obvious parts, there's a registration module.xml file just to define the module itself. I'm coming up with an XML layout. I'm coming up with a PHTML, a required JS configuration, and less files. And as soon as you dive into normal front-end development, these parts, these elements should be familiar, basically. However, the real trick that I did actually lies within this little list. So what I wanted to do was integrate React into Magento frontend itself. And to do so, you can see right there that actually there's this React.js library, which is a copy from React 16 downloaded from their site, React-DOM, the same case. And what I simply did was copy the pre-compiled version into Magento, the required JS-based front-end. But I'm coming back to this point later on, but it has a purpose. So it's a pre-compiled version, not with the normal React code that you would use in a React development environment, but actually a pre-compiled library to get you going in the normal front-end. There's also a package.json file, there's a gulp file, but those two are actually only needed to get to the final part, and that's it, basically the big thing or the big experiment that I did. There's a source and a compiled version. So what I'm doing is actually I'm using gulp to compile React code into something that is loaded in the browser directly. And you have to do this because of browser compatibility. So as soon as you dive into React development, somebody's going to propose to use Webpack or a similar tool to compile source code from React into, well, compiled code that runs in every browser. But normally they would use Webpack to do this compilation process. I've chosen gulp. That seems a little bit outdated, but for a reason as well. I'm getting back to this point. First of all, that's the set of files. I'm going to open a couple of those files just to see like what is inside. And what I did was basically I opened up the minicart itself using my browser, the Element Inspector. And then from this moment onwards, what I simply did was copy all of the code that I saw in the browser into the source files that were slowly becoming my React components. And instead of actually removing a lot of things manually, PHP Storm helped me by, well, removing a lot of the Knockout stuff more or less like automatically. With the right shortcuts, you can just find and replace the original Knockout code with nothing. So that's basically removing all of the Knockout tags. While in the same way, actually, there's another trick, but I will show you in a slide later on. So what I did was simply from the browser, I took the live version of the minicart, and I converted it into a really basic HTML version so that all of the HTML classes, HTML IDs, HTML elements were similar. So the look and feel of the minicart was the same, but it's missing all of the Knockout behavior, all of the automatic JavaScript behavior. Next, I copied this into PHP Storm itself, and then the nice thing is actually with PHP Storm, there's a couple of HTML arguments being converted into JSX syntax. So basically, once you convert HTML into React, there's a couple of steps to be taken, and PHP Storm is simply helping along with that. And then on top of that, because I was removing the knockout logic at first, I needed to re-add the same logic in React, meaning that you stare at this static HTML part within a React component. But then, for instance, the mini cart has this click behavior. You click on the mini cart, and then actually the whole pop-up with the mini cart contents is showing up. Well, this pop-up is driven by a click handler in React. Likewise, I populated the properties of this mini cart directly from local storage, which feels a little bit like a hack. However, I'm not running this experiment to do a React implementation of a Magento cart properly. No, I'm just doing it as an experiment to prove that whatever is there in Knockout could be replaced with React itself. Another one, pretty funny. There was this HTML element that I personally didn't know about, details. Meaning that as soon as you have this element, you click on the details and it's expanding. So instead of rewriting this with jQuery and some kind of more difficult solution, there's actually already an HTML element helping me along with that. But basically, the migration method was simply copying and pasting from the browser into a React environment and just modifying the code to make it work in a proper way. However, of course, I'm not done yet. I still need to hook in all of this React code into Magento itself. So what I had after this migration was basically a lot of React source files, a lot of component files that were written for React itself. All of those components, they need to be converted back into required JS code. And it starts basically with a simple configuration in required JS itself. In my purpose, or in my storyline, I've been using three different components. There's this React minicart component, or that's basically an alias for this thing called container. I'm going to show the source code of this container later on. Then there's this React minicart component, which originates from actual React code, but is compiled using gulp into, well, something that runs in the browser. And I had another little widget called the customer data, basically the knockout customer data that you would use in, well, the mini cart and the checkout and all over the place in the current front end, but now actually converted into React code. This is actually an old configuration because a couple of days before this event, I split it up to have a separate module, Yirio React, to simply offer these aliases of React and React DOM so that multiple React components in the whole frontend could use the same libraries of React and React DOM. And this is actually part of the reason why I'm not compiling a complete React developer environment into browser code, because then you would end up with one huge blob of JavaScript code, including React DOM, including my mini cart and my customer data. But as soon as you have another place in the same front end of Magento that is needing React as well, then you would create a second blob, which is again including React and including React DOM. So I need to play along with React. Woo! It's almost emptying out, and then I need a password. So to prevent actually that React and React DOM would be loaded twice on the page, I need to play ball with React with required.js itself, allowing me to load required.js to load React and React DOM through required.js itself. I'll get back to this point at the end of my presentation to look ahead in the future a little bit, like, okay, but this is an experiment, and now what to do next. The PHTML template is simply a placeholder so that this HTML content is replaced with actual React content. So it's just copy and paste and get the thing going. And then actually the magic comes within the container. I see this container as the glue between the old frontend and the new frontend. I'm simply calling upon React itself. You can see there that React.createElement is used to render my component in a certain way. And this rendering process is basically the same thing that you would use in a normal React app itself. However, instead of having a dummy shell that is like the beginning of a normal React app, I already have a shell, and it's not a dummy shell, but it's a complete HTML document run by Magento itself. And I just want to make sure that somewhere in this HTML document, React is being used initializing my single component, and etc. Now another thing pops up. If you start with React, one of the things that you learn from React is basically that every component has a state, and as soon as the state is changing, the component itself needs to be re-rendered. And that's actually what I've done here. As soon as the state of the component would be changing, I need to re-render the React component. However, I'm not letting React itself re-render the component. I'm manually doing it in my container component. So I know what kind of circumstance there is under which actually my component needs to be re-rendered. And that circumstance is simple whenever the card actually changes on the knockout level. So it's knockout code and React code actually glued together in such a way that it's simply working. So the container basically is the main trick that I had. And from this container onwards, I was able to play along with it. I was able to create React code. So this is just a sample of a dummy React component. What I did was I copied all of the HTML from the browser in this React component. And then I got the ball going. And actually, I'm not diving that much into the React code itself. But that's basically the beginnings of how to develop in React. You start with a component, this component becomes too big, so then the component is split up into smaller components and smaller components and smaller components, so that every component is actually doing a single thing, a single purpose. So that's what I basically did. I divided it into better code, reusable components, etc. But actually the previous slide, this glue between React and Knockout, that's actually the main point where I got started. Another part which is a little bit tricky is Gulp, and not Webpack, or at least not the Webpack configuration that is offered to you by the default Create React app, or like the normal development environments for React. And the reason is basically because Webpack wants to do a lot of different things combined into a single configuration. And part of this single configuration would be to start up an NPM or a Node web server. And it would be to compile a lot of different React code into one major JavaScript stream, so that React and React DOM and my own components and all of the other components would be shipped as one big JavaScript blob. But I didn't want to do that. I wanted to make sure that every component would be compiled into a separate JavaScript source, so that not Webpack or something React-like, but actually Require.js is able to convert this into a proper resource loaded by Require.js. So this is, again, like an attempt to make sure that Require.js is actually the end result, and it's not something halfway in between that normally is done by React itself. So that's actually relying actually on these two lines. I'm compiling all of the source code using this third-party library called Babel from React into ES2015 code, so regular browser code, but then transforming it on top of that to AMD style, which is Require.js. And that's basically the main trick. So if you open up all of my React components now in the browser, you would see no longer React code, but actually this intermediate blob of AMD code, which works in Magento, but it's no longer actually React itself. However, the end result is that everything is working. The mini card was migrated from one place to another. So what I then say is cat in het bakkie. It's a good reason to show a cat, but it's also a Dutch phrase just to show that, well, I don't have a clue, actually. So we say when something is working, we put a cat in a basket, and then we say cat in het bakkie. Okay. The end result was it's working. So now I had this mini card React component, which resembled actually all of the functionality in Knockout. I've added this KO Knockout listener to re-render the React components whenever I needed to. So then I could glue Knockout and React together for all of the rendering processes. I created also this simple customer data thing, which is only a mapping between React and actually local storage to get whatever was there from Magento from local storage into my React component. And it's working, more or less. There's a couple of limitations. Translations is still something that is not really working. As soon as I think like, hey, but this Knockout way of communicating or fetching data from the card is much more complicated than just local storage. Once you've opened up customerdata.js in Magento itself, you know actually that there's all this whole synchronization mechanism with sections and AJAX calls and cache invalidation, etc. I didn't replay all of that because I only replaced actually the mini card. And the mini card is only the representation of something that is already in the card. So the bindings, more or less, between React itself and the rest of the shop is only related to local storage. But it got me going because, well, basically I learned a lot of things from this small experiment. One big thing that I learned is that Knockout sucks, but React sucks less. Simply that, well, whatever front-end development tool you use, whatever front-end environment you're developing in, there's always limitations, there's always things that are being more complicated than you actually want, but that's the nature maybe of front-end technology at this moment. But at least we know that Knockout is outdated, overly complex in Magento, and replacing it with React gets the ball going in a pretty nice way. The second thing was actually that what I learned personally from my own little experiment is that it's kind of easy to migrate. I've tracked actually the amount of time that I was busy with this whole experiment, and the outcome simply surprised me. So I'm a developer. I was already knowledgeable about React itself, so I had a React learning curve which got me to a certain level. But then at the moment when I started off with this little experiment, I didn't actually know what would be needed actually to migrate from the React mini, or sorry, the Knockout mini card into a React mini card, and what kind of side issues I would have or other problems I would bump into. So I reserved actually 2 weekends for this, and I started off with the first weekend just simply copying and pasting, just like I mentioned earlier on the slide. Well, half an hour later, I was done copying and pasting. I was done cleaning up the code, and I had a simple React component. Then it took me about 1.5 hours to find out how to glue React and Knockout together, but that was it. Then it took me another hour to actually think it over a little bit better, like create a whole module, make it proven to be working in different environments. No testing, but at least like it was working for me. It was an experiment. And then actually another hour to clean it up, finalize it a little bit. And then I stared at my computer screen and I realized like, oh, but I'm done. So in 4 hours' time, I actually migrated this original mini card into a React mini card. Well, actually, of those 4 hours, only 2 hours were spent on finding out what would be the best way to do this. So it's proving actually a point where we're ready to go. And even better, PWA is going to be the next front end. It's going to determine the future. And React is maybe your choice also to build your own PWAs. And if you do, with Magento 2.3, PWA Studio will be more or less released officially. It's already out there, so you could already start playing with it. Plus, additionally, Magento 2.3 will add GraphQL itself as well, meaning that instead of relying on local storage, what I could do is just refactor my mini card in React to actually rely on the GraphQL API instead of actually the local storage part that was part of this customer data thing that we actually hate. So Magento 2.3 is marking like the next phase of rewriting this little experiment to become even better. And that's basically where my suggestion to you guys also starts. So what I simply did as an experiment was migrate one little component. The component might be fairly simple, but that's not the main point. The main point is actually that React development or Vue development or possibly other frameworks is just much easier to adopt to than Magento 2 front-end technology. So there's no reason for the long term to actually migrate to this new situation. But instead of going from one Magento 2 shop that might have been finished just a couple of months ago directly into PWA is a huge investment. And at least my little experiment shows that maybe part of the current front end could gradually be replaced with React components just to get migrated slowly. Not directly, not full PWA, but like a half-breed situation in between. And that's actually it. If you have any questions, shoot. And otherwise, thank you. Oh, and one remark that I wanted to make. Sonja from IntegerNet also mentioned in her talk that IntegerNet actually also worked upon, or actually did she? But, well, I know that IntegerNet actually also worked upon a React component, and not a simple React component like mine, but actually a replacement of the checkout itself. So slowly, like across the community, more people are migrating their old front-end code into React components. And that means that my presentation is just part of like a bigger experiment by the community itself. So hopefully in the end, we can share a lot of React components and get going, learn from each other. Any questions? Lukasz?
Hi. Did you notice any noticeable performance difference between, say, the knockout version of the Minikart versus the React version?
No, not necessarily. Okay. So that's the funny part. Actually, it's not a headless environment. I'm still loading the regular front end. And theoretically, there's a minor difference between the rendering of things through knockout and rendering it through React. But I didn't see a big performance thing because it's not a headless approach yet.
Okay.
Well, no questions, then thanks and catch you later.